Today, my name is Robin Davis. I am presently working in NIT Calicut as assistant professor. So the topic that we are going to look at in this session is performance-based seismic analysis and design. To give an introduction, so before coming to the exact topic, I would like to acknowledge many people with whom the experience, the presentation is actually the product of that experience that we got by working with many people. Professor Devadas Menon, IIT Madras, Professor Maya Prasad, IIT Madras, Professor Amlanson Gupta, IIT Madras, and there are many people. Acknowledgement to them. Let me start with the first slide. So this is the contents of this presentation. It deals with the performance-based earthquake engineering. Though it is on the earthquake engineering topic, it can be applied to other any kind of hazards like earthquake. As an example, I am always telling about earthquake. So it can be even applied to flood, it can be applied to tsunami, it can be applied to cyclone or any hazards that we face in our day-to-day life, or particularly regarding the structural aspects. So the presentations will cover the terminologies in performance-based earthquake engineering. There are some parts of performance-based earthquake engineering that we should know. And one important terminology is the performance objective. How do we predict the performance, and some case studies. So before going to the performance-based design, let us look at how we do a conventional design using our present code. So we call that procedure as force-based design, because we find the forces from the natural period of the structure, and then we distribute it over the floors. So here you can see Q1, Q2, Q3 are the shear force or the lateral force distributed at the floor levels. I think many of you know this. First we will calculate the base shear, which is the total base shear or the design base shear of the building. And then we will distribute it at every floor. If you add up, it will be the total base shear. And it is done as per the code expression, which follows a parabolic distribution across the height. So this is the first step in when we do the design of using force-based design. So we call it as force-based design because we calculate the force and then design the structures or design the members. So what are the forces we do? We consider the gravity loads, and we apply the lateral loads. And in the analysis, we assume that the members are elastic, and we find the moments, shear forces, axial forces in all the members, beams, columns, etc. And then we size the component, like if it is a beam if it is a column, we size the component in such a way that the force demand is less than the capacity. So this process is called the design. So that means we found the forces, and if you do the design for that force, we assume that the structure is safe. Okay, now one extra thing what we do is we check for deflections, and sometimes we also do the crack widths and the drift of the building. So we check the drift of the building So particularly for the lateral load, suppose there is an earthquake load, we will take the drift and we will check the drift is less than 0.4%. So this is what we conventionally do when we do the design. But over the period, what people found is there were a lot of earthquake events, and most of the structures, either it is collapsed completely or sometimes it is collapsed partially, right? So here you can see that the Andaman earthquake, one building is collapsed. You can see the collapsed elements here. And other one is a famous picture, the failure of a building where the top portion, which is the water tank, is failed, Bhuj 2001, and a bridge in Sumatra earthquake, and then another building in Bhuj. So ground story is totally collapsed. And another one building in Northridge earthquake. So it is, you can see that the when you look at the building, there is no much much damage to the building, right? Except that you can see that the beam column joints are are damaged, and but the upper portions are not much damaged. But after the earthquake, it is reported that the building is demolished. So it is like we are so for this building, the loss is like 100%. Like, even though the loss is, the damage is less in the building, the building is replaced. That means full cost is incurred. So this is the, so the what I want to tell here is sometimes the damage may not be such that the we may not need to demolish the entire building entire building and construct new one. So sometimes it may be partial. So this is where the importance of performance based design. So let's see why the performance based seismic designer, or what is the importance. So why do we go for this performance based seismic design? Okay, so you can see that hazards, the first line is on the idea that hazards are inevitable. It comes and go. So, and its levels are also unpredictable. So like earthquake, any other type of hazards that we face are not, we cannot avoid it. And it is also sometimes not predictable. All the structures cannot be designed for all the levels of hazards. And hazards may or may not damage the structure completely. Okay, so it's a challenge to predict the level of damage of the structure at various levels of hazard and the associated cost. So so this is where the importance of performance-based seismic design. So here we should be able to, as a structural engineer, the challenge is to predict the damage in a structure. Suppose a hazard is or an event is happening. And we should also be able to tell how much is the associated cost or the cost of repair or sometimes even replacement. So this idea, if we can give to the owner, it will be much helpful, because he take a decision accordingly. So the cost performance format is the outcome of the performance based design. So in that, this format may help the owners to make critical decisions on whether he should spend how much amount of money, right? And another questions are, how many members can damage in a frequent small earthquakes? So there are many earthquakes or which are frequent, that there may not be an intense earthquake. So in a frequent earthquakes, whether the members can damage or not, or what is the level of damage, or how many beams and columns or beam column joint needs to be repaired in a low intensity earthquake event, or how many columns will damage, will there be any pancake mode of collapse, or the building, whether the building is operational after a few days, or will there be any casualty, or what is the what is the economic burden for the repair of damage? So these are some of the questions that any owner can ask. Okay, so so due to this, the entire earthquake engineering in the coming 10 years may change, and it may revise. Due to this, a lot of code revision may take place. So not only earthquake, if all the codes are moving in this direction, so there are a lot of things that researchers should look at. Now, performance. Coming to the performance. Performance is a state of damage of the building. So it is a either it can be. So there are a lot of parameters to define the state of damage of a building. So it can be strain in the members or deformation of the members. Sometimes we can even consider the roof drift or the drift of the members. Or the deformation of the members, or state of damage is like a continuous spectrum of a so the parameter it can be represented as a continuous spectrum because it can take any value. So damage state. Now, why do we need damage state? Because when an event comes, initially the building may be undamaged. So when the intensity increases, you can see slight damage. So each and every, even though it is a continuous spectrum, damage is a continuous spectrum, we need to we should be able to define some particular damage state where it is not useful for a particular purpose. For example, suppose the damage is very less, right? For example, here, the damage here is only slight. So if this is acceptable, we can do some repairs and then reuse the building. So maybe the damage happened to the building is not very serious. So this can be classified as, let's say, some particular name to that. So this limit states, or we call the damage states, can be defined so that we can look at the performance of the building or the how the building perform for that particular defined damage state. Okay, so people have defined some damage state, which is one thing is the slight damage or the immediate occupancy damage state, or we in another way is we call it as a performance level. Okay, so although you can have any type of damage, so this is like some damage state is defined so that the building after the earthquake event should be useful, should be able to reuse it. Okay. So the members in this damaged state may retain their strength and stiffness. Crushing of concrete should not be there. Some hairline crack can be seen, and the transient drift. That means the drift, the maximum drift in the free vibration stage can be even 1%. It can go to 1%, but should not have the building should not have a permanent drift, right? So these are some of the definitions of the damage state or the performance level of the building. For some cases, for example, here in the same damage state, it is also defined that risk of life-threatening injury is very less, and there is the building should be repaired with minor repair works. So, and most important thing is the building can be reoccupied before the repairs. So before doing any repairs itself, it should be able to, we should be able to use it. And life safety performance level is another critical point, or the damage state of the building. where there can be significant damage to the building, and beams may be damaged, and the spalling of the concrete cover may be there. So, and the transient drift can go up to 2%, but with a 1% permanent drift. Okay, so and the life threatening injury is very is low, so there should not be any life threatening cases. So major structural repair can be done, so partial repair should be done before repair. So some days, some business interruption may be there if the building is in this level, but surely it can be used after the partial repair. So this is another state. And then the third one is collapse prevention, which is defined as the building will have extensive cracking and dislodging of wall, significant risk of injury. There can be risk to the life also, and the building may not be repairable. So sometimes the state of the building is such that it is going to be collapsed. So degradation of lateral load system can be observed. Vertical load system supports the gravity load without any margin of safety against collapse. So after this, it may collapse. Any other minor earthquake events after this, immediately the structure may collapse, and there can be formation of hinges in the ductile elements, and about 4% permanent drift is allowed. Up to this, so if these criteria are satisfied after the event, then we can call that the building is in this particular collapse prevention damage state. Okay, similarly, we can also define the performance of the structure performance levels for non-structural elements. So in this direction, many research works are happening now. So most of the research were concentrated on the structural performance of structural elements till now. So people can also look at, for example, if it is a hospital building, we may have to look at many things like the apparatus, the machines in the hospital should be working even after earthquakes. So there are many non-structural elements in the building for which the performance can be assessed like this. So it includes building cladding, glazing, partitions, fault ceilings, parapets, chajas, chimneys, stairs, balconies, heating equipments, ventilation and air conditioning ducts, distribution boxes, lighting fixtures, pipes and plumbing fixtures. So in a hospital building, we may have to worry about these things, because in such an event, this hospital should be functional even after the event. Okay, so now classification of this performance level is done. So the summary is this: there is a immediate occupancy performance level, life safety and collapse prevention. So immediate occupancy will come if we target an immediate occupancy performance level than a life safety, we call it the we are going towards higher performance. Okay, so as we go down, it is the lower performance. So for a very important building, we need to look at the higher performance level. Okay, so that is why it depends on the owner to choose which performance level should be targeted, so that he can make some decisions on the cost. Okay, sometimes people have defined ISD in terms of ISD. For example, IO, LS, CP can be defined in terms of ISD. That means inter-story drift. So if the inter-story drift is 1%, then we can say that the building is in IO limit state. Similarly, 2% and 4%. There are many studies using this drift limits. There is another one, Park and Ank damage index. So the expression is not given here. So similar, similar to this 1%, 2%, 4%. It is given with another numbers like 0.4%, 0.4, 0.4 to 1 and greater than 1. People have also looked at the strain in concrete, sometimes 0.0035. Then life safety for collapse prevention. So these are all available. Some studies are available in the literature. Okay, so we talked about earthquake. So earthquake can have different levels. Okay, so so we need to characterize the earthquake. So it is based on many, people use many parameters. Sometimes they used according to the PGA. Sometimes people use SAT1, which is the spectral accelerations corresponding to the fundamental time period. So there are many parameters, right? So for sure we should have some idea about the earthquake at a particular site. So typical ground motion hazard curve defines the probability of exceedance of a particular earthquake event, and it gives this the information with respect to a ground motion intensity. That means sometimes it is PGA. So PGA versus annual rate of exceedance can be seen here. So the meaning is if the PGA, so as PGA increases, the event will become intense. That means ground motion intensity increases. Though such earthquakes are very rare. Sometimes if the earthquake intensity lower, so there can be many frequent earthquakes. So these are all called return period. So in a return period of 75 years, there can be many frequent earthquakes having this magnitude. And if it is 500 years, the intensity may be higher. So this basically defines the hazard curve of a particular site. So for every site which is close to a fault location, we can actually find out, the geotechnical engineers will do this work. So they can make a hazard curve, which will be used by the structural engineers to analyze the structure and tell that what is the probability of damage of a building given a particular earthquake. Okay, so how it, so one thing is called return period, which is a parameter for a any event which is repeating. So if the probability that an event occurs at least once in T years, this can be modeled like a Poisson's process. So this is the Poisson equation. If you rearrange this equation, we can find N, which is the return period. So if we consider 50 years design life, we can substitute here 50 years. And then if you know the probability of exceedance, we can find the return period of a particular event. Okay, so it is just a convenient format. Sometimes we express in terms of probability or the return period. Okay, so some earthquake levels are given here. We need to identify. Similarly, earthquake levels can be anything, but we take some we define some levels of earthquakes that we use it later, so that we can actually map the earthquake level with the damage. So that is the purpose. Okay, so we can define a serviceability earthquake with the probability of occurrence is 50% in 50 years. So the return period is 72 years, approximate N is 75. So we can categorize this as frequent earthquakes. Now another serviceability earthquake, which is 20% in 50 years. We get the return period as 225. And design basis earthquake, so this many people might have heard. It is the probability of earthquake occurrence is 10% in 50 years. And where return period is 475. And we can also similarly define the maximum considered earthquake with 5% in 50 years or 10% in 100 years. So accordingly, we will get the return period. So these are called very rare and extremely rare, with 2% in 50 years, which will come once in 2500 years. So so these are the levels of earthquake that we define. Now coming to the objectives, performance objective. So performance objective is having seen the earthquake levels. Now we understood that there are some levels of earthquake defined based on the probability of occurrence or the return period. So we need to now map this earthquake levels with the building performance. So this is the demand and this is the building. So that means the capacity. So we need to look at, for a particular earthquake level, we can now map the performance of the building. So if you map like that, we call those that procedure or that that mapped items as performance objectives. So we can define the performance objective. For example, DB. For a DBE earthquake, suppose we are targeting a building performance of IO. So this is a performance objective. Okay, or if you target in an MCE level of earthquake, if you target at collapse prevention performance level, or if you look at the collapse prevention performance level, then we call it as a performance objective. So performance objective is a mapping of earthquake level with the target building performance levels. Okay, so we can see this left part, we are familiar now. These are the levels of earthquake. Okay, so we define 50% in 50 years, 20% in 50 years. So serviceability earthquake 1 to, and DBE and MCE. So we can now, so these are the target building performance level. So sometimes we define another one called operational and immediate occupancy, life safety and collapse prevention. So this is a matrix. So the matrix, suppose this is a performance objective, this will define a performance objective, which is a design basis earthquake. In a design basis of earthquake, suppose we target the life safety, then that is actually K. This is written as K. Now another similar basic safety objective is, in a MCE level, if you target collapse prevention, we call it as another objective, performance objective. So so these two are actually, we are even doing in our force based design partially. Okay, so in force based design by default we don't want any life threatening cases or life so it should ensure life safety if you design for design basis earthquake. Similarly, if you design for maximum considered earthquake, the building should not collapse. So these are already targeted in the current design, but other levels. So if you suppose we want to look at, in a maximum considered earthquake, suppose we want to look at the life safety, so we need to define the performance objective accordingly. So these are some terminologies used in the performance based design. Now similar, so right, so far we have seen the structural performance levels, but in AAC in the recent version they have defined even the performance of non-structural elements. Okay, so they call it as non-structural performance level. Sometimes if it is an important building, we need to look at the non-structural performance also, right? So there is similar metrics given for the mapping between structure and non-structural elements. I'm not going to the detail of it. Okay, now for a performance-based earthquake engineering, to make it possible, we need to have certain minimum things. So one is that we need to have, we should be able to establish the probability-based representation to assess the performance. Even there are many studies without this, we can also do without that. And Another thing is that we need a structural analysis tool to simulate or predict the response of the structure as accurately as possible. So there can be some uncertainties even in the structural model that we use. So we need to minimize the modeling uncertainties. Maybe we have to look at the structural models which can map the or which can simulate the experiments initially. And then once we validated the model, then it may sometimes give a better prediction. So and other thing is that we need also look at the hazard or the probability of occurrence of the hazard at a particular site. So sometimes if it is a seismic case, we may have to see the site specific ground motions, because that is the demand. And other thing is that we need a knowledge about structural capacity and material properties and its variability, because there can be some variability in the case of material properties and the geometric properties of the structure. So this can actually affect our prediction. So in a probability based representation, we need to have idea about the structural capacity variability. Okay, so coming to the structural analysis. So this presentation, I would like to also touch upon some of the tools or some of the important aspects of structural analysis that we need to consider when when we try to predict the response of the structure. Although many people knows this, so as a formality, I'm just discussing on the non-linearity that we need to consider when we look at the structural analysis tools. It should actually consider the material non-linearity and geometric non-linearity. So we know what is the what is the importance of that, or how it is how it can affect the results. So in geometric nonlinearity, equilibrium will be considered in the deformed configurations, so which cannot be. So in the normal analysis without geometric nonlinearity, we don't look at the equilibrium of the structure in the deformed configuration. Okay, other nonlinearity is material nonlinearity, that everyone knows this. So we cannot use the assumption of this linear material properties, so it can go. So we may have to look at the stress strain curve of the materials. Suppose it is reinforced concrete, we have to see what is the reliable stress strain curve of the concrete. We may have to include the effect of confinement, etc., to have a proper prediction of the response. Okay, so linear versus non-linear, this is also everybody knows. Linear behavior is limited to the region of small response. When high stresses are involved, we need to look at the material non-linearity and the displacement. The displacements are large, we should also consider the geometric non-linearity. And if the loading is removed at a large response, there can be the residual response. So the linear analysis cannot consider all this, so we need to always consider nonlinear modeling. So in the nonlinear modeling itself, there can be hardening, there can be sometimes softening, and sometimes we use approximate elastoplastic elastic perfectly plastic models. Okay, so if you to understand what is happening, if you consider the non-linearity in the material non-linearity, so if we deal with the frame elements, so when a particular member is yielded or damaged, so automatically some forces should be transferred to the other joints. So to understand this concept, we have our an example here. Which will be exactly like our limit analysis or plastic hinge analysis of structural steel. So similar to that, we can also consider similar analysis in the reinforced concrete, because we are all, I think, mostly worried about, although most we have steel structures, so this particular presentation deals with the reinforced concrete structures. So when we look at the performance of RC frame structures when a particular joint is yielded, so we have to model that joint as elastic perfectly plastic, or you can see the moment curvature relationship, which is yielding at a particular point and then flat. So this is this information is to be given in the model when we use the plastic hinges for nonlinear analysis. So this example will explain what is happening, or the sequence of plastic hinge formation more clearly. So let's imagine a continuous beam where W, the UD load in the beam, is less than its capacity, that means W1, and for that cases we can, so first thing is that we design this continuous beam at this section we designed, and then the capacity of the of the moment capacity at this section is MUR, and here we provided a negative moment reinforcement, and here it is a sagging moment, so we have given a same MUR or the same sections and reinforcement at the sagging moment also. So we can tell that all these three sections are designed for a moment capacity of MUR. Now if you look at the bending moment, suppose we apply W1, where W1 is the capacity of the capacity in terms of the load, UD load. So if you apply, we will get here the MUR by L square, MUR by L square divided by 0.125. So we can actually write MUR as 0.125 W1 L square. Similarly here, if you write in terms of moment, so it will have capacity. From the capacity side, it is 0.5624 MUR. So when you apply W equal to W1, the this portion of the beam may yield, because the MUR reaches moment reach at that point reaches MUR, whereas in this section the moment is still not reached its capacity. It may its capacity. So that it is understandable from this diagram. So you can see here this value is MUR. So it is when the load, uniform load intensity is W1. Suppose we keep increasing the load W, the moment will be, so the initially the moment here will be less than MUR. Now once we keep increasing the moment, there will be transfer of moments from here to the sagging side, and so because of that the moment here may reach, or it may reach MUR, but this is happening at a load of 1.46 W1, where W1 is the load for the moment hinge to take place only in this point. Okay, so this is what is happening. So this is diagrammatically explained here. So this portion you can see, so this is, this graph is y-axis is moment, x-axis is the loading. Now this dotted line indicates the region of the negative moment, and this yellow line indicates this sagging moment region. Now when the load, so the x-axis is the load, when the load increases to W1, the moment at the negative moment point will be MUR. So this point will reach first, because in the sagging moment this moment would not have reached MUR at this moment. It is only 0.5624 MUR, right? So as moment increases further, this joint keeps rotating with a moment capacity of MUR, and in this process the positive moment region, the moment will be transferred to the positive moment region, and finally that will also be equal to mu1. So in this process, the total load carrying, the UD load carrying capacity of the beam is not W1, it is 1.46 times more than W1, right? So the beam is capable of carrying an extra 46% load beyond the limit of elastic behavior. So this is what the principle behind the nonlinear analysis using the point plasticity hinges that we will be discussing it. Okay. So you can see here in this an example of limit analysis. So some load is there, a frame is there, and some lateral load is acting. So the bending moment in the lateral loads will be something like this. So there are critical region. So once some of the joints reach its its capacity moment, so it may not take further moment further moment, and the extra moment will be distributed to the other joints. So this is happening in the plastic hinge formation sequence. Okay, so for modeling the nonlinearity, we should be able to get this nonlinear behavior, or we should be able to generate this nonlinear force deformation models for the reinforcements provided. Okay, so a lot of options are there. One is we can model as a plastic hinge, concentrated plasticity model, or we can also give a spring in which nonlinear, we call it as nonlinear spring hinges in some softwares. So we call it as concentrated plasticity hinges, and sometimes we can also go for distributed plasticity. That means it is like a fiber section, and entire column or beam is modeled as distributed plasticity. So the fiber elements will be considered at the Gauss points. And third option is the full finite element modeling. That means 3D finite element with nonlinear properties. Okay, so this is the distributed plasticity model available in, there are many softwares which can do this. One is, we can use SAP or OpenSys, or there are many other softwares like CSMOSTRUCT or CSMOSOFT, etc. So the RC sections in that particular fiber modeling is considered as unconfined concrete, which is actually the concrete outside the longitudinal bars, and along with the longitudinal bars and stirrups, the portion of this the concrete in this portion are confined. So we need to consider the confined concrete stress strain curve when it comes to this region. So it has some difference, because in the confined case there can be some additional stress this region of concrete can take. So so we need to model in this fashion, and apart from that we have the longitudinal reinforcement. So this is one type of modeling. So another way is lambda plasticity model, where we assign the concentrated plasticity hinges only at this point, at this end points, because our moments during the lateral load will be either like this or like this. So ends are prone to the yielding and then further load transfer to the other members. So we need to assign the hinges at the ends. Other option is fiber, that is shown here. So confined and unconfined stress strain curves are shown here. Okay, so curvature. And so we are just going to see some slides on this, how to derive the moment capacity relationship given a particular concrete section. Okay, so we need to see what is the curvature. So curvature is can be defined as from using the strain, if you know the strain in the outermost fibers, we can write curvature as like this, And if you know this curvature, so we can actually find out the moment curvature relationship of a particular beam RC section. So if there is a beam, cantilever beam, we can consider the moment diagram. So we get the curvature diagram. So if you know the curvature diagram, we can integrate the curvature to get the rotation. So we can give a plastic hinge here with a moment rotation relationship. If we can find the maximum moment and the rotation. So that's the idea. So this is the property of that rotational spring that we need to assign at this point. So for any type of beam, any beam with different arrangement of reinforcement, we should be able to do this because this is what, according to this only, the nonlinearity will be introduced in the frame. So moment curvature relationship, this everybody knows. So there are some assumptions that we use, plane section remain plane, etc., etc. So we can actually, so these are the differences in the confined and unconfined concrete section. Okay, so why this increase in stress? Because of the confinement. So you can see that epsilon cu may be more than that of the unconfined concrete. Okay, so because of the effect of the confinement steel, that means the effect of the stirrups are considered in this equation. So you can see that confined stresses is a function of unconfined stresses by a factor. So this is the factor that will increase the stress due to the confinement. Okay, so similarly we have the stress strain curve of steel. And suppose we have a beam section with a non-reinforcement area, we should be able to develop the moment curvature relationship, because this is what the input given to the program to predict the nonlinear behavior. So this shows a typical moment curvature relationship of the given beam. Effect of confinement. So we discussed on confinement. So confinement increases the stress capacity and also the strain capacity. So if a member is properly confined by giving the stirrups, its behavior or the moment curvature behavior also will be having some effect due to that. Okay, so this is the confinement does. So this stirrups may have some forces like this, and then because of that the concrete will be confined. Okay, so you can see here how the transverse reinforcement spacing affects the moment curvature relationship. This is the moment curvature curve for a particular spacing. So this is for D. Suppose we reduce the spacing, then it increases the curvature of the moment. So here the curvature effect, increase in the curvature is more when we decrease the spacing of the transverse reinforcement. Now modeling of the shear hinge. Sometimes the section might not have designed for shear. So in that case, we have to model the section or beam and column for the shear also. Sometimes it is designed for shear. The member may fail in flexure first. So in that case, we can ignore the shear force deformation or shear hinge property. So this is a typical shear strength versus shear deformation curve that we need to consider when we do the nonlinear analysis or the performance based analysis of the frames considering nonlinearity. Okay, so performance based earthquake engineering, so we have we can also, so since there is a time constraint, we will go with the, so there are many methods in performance-based earthquake engineering. So one is we can assess the performance using the nonlinear static pushover analysis with the help of a capacity spectrum method, so which will be explained in the coming slides.
Robin sir, is there any technical issues? Robin sir, can you hear me?
Robin, any problem? We are not. Robin, can you hear us? Sandeep, is there any problem?
Sir, I think there is a technical issue. So I'm just contacting Robin, sir. So participants, please wait for a minute.
Questions now. And I request you to unmute your mic and ask questions.
Please ask the questions. You may be having the doubts. I am requesting you to clear the doubts. The expert is available.
You can choose the chat box as well.
Robin, I have a doubt.
Yeah, sir.
You have told the influence of the transverse reinforcement, etc., for the deformation curvature, etc.
Yeah.
And I am asking you, what is the influence of this main reinforcement in it? Whether the quantity of main reinforcement is increased or decreased, something like that. If it is more than sufficient, what is going to be happened?
Yeah, so if it is increased, suppose in this case, we have RC section. So if you increase, sometimes it may go to the over reinforced side. There is a chance. So in that case, mostly suppose this is an under reinforced section behavior. So it may go up and then it may not have sufficient ductility. So this is one of the chance. Like so, if you increase the longitudinal reinforcement. So if you decrease, again there is a chance that it may reduce the moment capacity, so the ductility may be improved. Okay, so as we increase the longitudinal reinforcement, it may go to over reinforced side, so it may reduce the ductility.
What's the role of the inclined reinforcement? Sometimes at the joints to take shear, we are providing inclined reinforcement. Whether it is having any role in this activity.
Yeah, sir, inclined reinforcement, that you mean the for the stirrups, like this.
Yeah, stirrups. That's a shear.
Oh, okay. So
not this, for shear, anyhow, but that is the main reinforcement that
okay, you are saying that inclined stirrups.
Yeah.
Okay, so inclined stirrups, so it may improve the shear capacity. So accordingly, we may have to improve the shear behavior. So for example, here we can see the shear strength versus shear deformation of a particular cross section. So let's say we have inclined stirrups. So in that case, this may increase depending on the spacing and the angle that we give the reinforcement. So that may be the effect. I think people have not given a property, shear hinge properties for such cases, but this is my guess. It may happen that way.
In most of the cases in earthquake, the ground floor is failed first. Is there any way in preventing that?
Yeah, so one way is most of the time that so when we have shear distribution of the shear, the ground story will have more shear. So most probably that is the reason why the ground story columns are failed. One thing is that we have to, so ideally, some people used to say ideal, so this configuration of a moment resisting frame is something like this, which is not ideal. So ideal thing is that we should provide the capacity of the stories also like our shear distribution, because our shear is distributed something like this. So shear is maximum at the bottom. So if we do the or the proportion the building in this fashion, this is the ideal thing. But many times this may not be practical. So some people say that Egyptian pyramids are more stable because it is having this geometry. But for a moment resisting frame, our geometry itself is like this. So we don't have option to change after a particular limit. So other thing is that we need to provide the shear walls and then make the building stronger. So again, when we provide shear wall is one of the better solution for any of these problems. So one thing is that shear walls, when we provide, we need to provide it throughout the height. So maybe that can solve the problem.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I don't know. I hope the talk, I don't know this, many people understood or not. So thank you very much for giving an opportunity, sir. Okay.
Any more questions, please? Okay, then.
Okay, I hope no more questions left to us.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
I would like to take this opportunity to thank a resource person, Dr. Robin Davis, sir, for handling this session. So we are really glad to have you here for handling this session. It was very informative and fruitful, and I'm sure that everyone now has far more understanding of this topic. So on behalf of our civil engineering fraternity, I would like to thank you for the distinguished lecture. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Robin.
Yeah. So shall I log out, sir?
Okay, you can log
out.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, now, dear participants, I request you to kindly stay online. Now, we have come to the end of this online short-term training program organized by the Department of Civil Engineering, Muthoot Institute of Technology and Science. We are pleased to know your valuable feedbacks now. So, because your feedback and suggestions will help us to improve the upcoming similar programs. So, I request the participants to share your feedback.
Good afternoon, everyone. So, we have come to the end of the STTP that was arranged by the Department of Civil Engineering, MITS. The 3 days had been very productive to each one of us with all the different sessions that were organized. And actually, being in the final year and with the projects going on, the sessions were very helpful. We were able to come across several recent advancements of structures and materials in the civil engineering industry that were not known to us before. And also, many of us have considered using this Abaca software for aiding us on a project, and the sessions have been proved to be very effective. And various other topics were also covered related to our projects. So it had been very informative. So I thank the entire department for organizing this program and introducing us to such great resource persons. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. The STTP sessions were very much informative, and each of the topics were new. So these sessions helped us update our knowledge in the field of civil engineering. Also, I thank Sandeep sir and Binal sir and other faculties for giving us such an opportunity to hear from the resource persons from IITs and NITs and other colleges. So it will be helpful for our college projects and in the future too. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else is there?
Good evening, everyone. I'm so glad that our department came up with the initiative of conducting a 3-day online short-term training program on recent advancement in structures and materials. I'm pretty sure that it really brought an insight to all those who attended this with passion. Something I would like to really appreciate is that we got an opportunity to interact effectively with different personalities from various institutions across India to help us upgrade our knowledge in the field of structures and materials. It was informative in terms of understanding things in detail, and it really inspired us to think out of the box. Looking forward to more such events. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, all. The short-term training program, which was organized by Department of Civil Engineering, MITS, has been really wonderful, especially for students who will be in the real civil engineering application field in the coming years. Apart from the academic topics, we got introduced to many other relevant contents, that too from highly dignified resource persons from various prestigious institutions all over India. This opportunity was an exposure to various innovations and software that drive civil engineering domain currently. The sessions really inspired us and opened up a wide range of potential areas of our project and future studies. I take this opportunity to thank the faculty and other participants, and I extend my sincere gratitude to all the speakers who took out time from their busy schedule to cooperate with us in this insightful event. Thank you.
Thank you. Any more? Anybody else is there to share your view? Okay. So thank you all for your valuable words. Now I request our head of the department, Dr. Babu Kurian sir, to share a few words.
Thank you, Nishida. Dear participants, I am happy that the 3-day short-term training program is successfully completed. I am taking this opportunity to congratulate the coordinators, Dr. M.S. Sandeep and Sri Binod Varghese, for the successful conduct of this program. Let me also congratulate the whole faculty of civil engineering for their cooperation with the coordinators for the success of these programs. Lifelong learning. This is what is required for a professional to be successful in his career. Hope we could provide something to this process by conducting this short-term training program. The resource people from reputed institutions all over India, from India, and they are experts in their field, and they could share their experiences in this platform, and I am sure that this will help the participants to continue their studies, at least in one of the topics they have shared with you. And I am wishing you all the very best. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So, dear participants, the link for sharing your feedback will be shared with you soon. So please fill up the feedback form, and also you'll get the certificates through your registered mail ID after submitting the feedback. Okay. And we'll share the link to the recorded sessions through the registered mail ID. Now I request you to turn on the camera so that we can click a screenshot. Please turn on the camera.
Okay, thank you all. Now, on behalf of the Department of Civil Engineering, I would like to thank you all for patiently attending this session. Thank you very much. Thank you all. So we have come to the end of this short-term training program. You all can leave now.
Thank you all once more.